Can I? Okay. Let's start again. I was talking about the way, I mean, just to give you a flavor, an idea of calculations which can be done using quantum field theory. At the basis of this calculation, there is a normalization scheme, okay, which relates some quantities, which could be the inverse correlation length of the mass of the system, the coupling, the normalized coupling, okay, defined in this way. I mean, this relation defines the coupling, and the parameters which are related to the, I mean, to the model, the Bayer model, okay, which are the quadratic parameter R and the quartic term. Okay, so we construct in this scheme, we construct a normalization group equation, I mean, and actually infinite normalization group equations. They are, we introduce two functions, the beta function and the RG functions here. I mean, the point is that if we analyze this equation, we can easily understand that actually this function here can be computed using perturbation theory. That's the first point. So if we analyze this, the normalization group equations can be easily see, okay, I invite you to give a look at the books. You can find this in the textbooks, that when m goes to zero, so when the inverse correlation length goes to zero, so the correlation goes to infinity or the mass goes to zero, then the coupling is driven toward the fixed point of the beta function. I mean, fixed point means at zero, mean of the beta function. So, in order to understand, to solve this critical, to get the flow, the normalization group flow, we need to compute this function here, which are particularly important. And they can be done by computed by perturbation theory. For example, this in the case of n models, these functions have been computed to 6, 7 loops. Then, when we compute beta, the beta function, we determine the zero of the beta function, okay? And we can get information on the critical exponents, because there are simple relations between the critical exponents, which are two independent critical exponents, and the RG functions introduced in normalization group equations. Actually, one must be careful, because these are perturbative expansions. They are asymptotic, they are not convergent, I mean, for this theory, so accurate calculation can be done exploiting Borel's summability. In this case, in this scheme, Borel's summability has been proved by Parisi in the 70s. This also includes some kind of instanton calculations in order to compute the large order behavior of the perturbative expansions. This is not only the only, it's not the only scheme. We can also introduce other schemes. For example, the so-called MS bar normalization scheme, okay, which also the same scheme used in the high energy physics. And this scheme, for example, leads to the so-called epsilon expansion or other three-dimensional systems. And one can get similar, I mean, normalization group equations can get. The beta functions, they can be computed perturbatively. The main difference is that this scheme is defined on the massive, for the massive theory, for the high temperature phase, I mean, while this scheme can be also defined at the critical point. Okay, let me consider the easing universality class, which is the simplest universality class, non-trivial universality class. Let me consider it in three dimensions. This universality class is characterized by Z2 symmetry, I mean, and we have this theory, the 5 to the 4 theory. We can perform calculation for the 5 to the 4 theory. Calculation have been done up to 6, 7 loops, as I said before, and the scheme, zero momentum scheme I showed you before, and to order epsilon to the 5 loop for the perturbative. it compared with the other approaches, in particular with experiments. These are experiments. These are numbers obtained from experiments on liquid vapor transition. I mean, fluid mixtures, and also uniaxial magnets. So very different systems. All these systems give analogous numbers. Actually, the theory says that these numbers should be the same asymptotically. So this we have exact prediction. We have here also comparison with the numerical simulations. Numerical simulations using Monte Carlo. These are lattice techniques. These are high temperature expansion. These are Monte Carlo simulations. And let me also show you some results using conformal field theory. These are new results, more recent results. And they are very promising, in particular, assuming a saturation unitarity bound, one can get. It's done by two different groups. I mean, it's a finite size scaling. I'll show you. I unfortunately didn't have enough space to show you the references. Okay, but if you want, I can give you the references of these works. Okay. Okay. These are the critical exponents. This is the exponent associated with the diverging correlation length. Alpha is the specific heat exponent. That's related to the diverging behavior of the specific heat. Eta is related to the behavior of a two-point function at the critical point. Large X behavior. I mean, it's power law behavior at the critical point, and eta describes this behavior. That's essentially the deviation from a Gaussian behavior. And beta is the exponent associated with the magnetization. Okay? Only two of them are independent. Okay? Using scaling, hyperscaling relations, you can relate all exponents to two. So if you determine two exponents in this case, you get all asymptotic contributions, at least the critical exponents. That's what I mean. Okay? Yeah? Well, what do you do? When you do perform a numerical simulation, you enlarge the sides of the box. You can do that just changing the input parameter, and you check what happens. Finite size scaling theory tells us how the properties of the system change when we are at the phase transition. So we match the prediction, the finite size scaling theory, with what we observe numerically. This matching gives us information on the critical exponents, the critical temperature, whatever you want. The same. In that case, you change the temperature. If you have an inference system, you change the temperature. You get now. First, I'm here. You see, this is another transition. This is a transition on the helium 4. This is an experiment done on the space shuttle to reach, which allowed the authors of this experiment to reach a reduced temperature of 10 to minus 9. I mean, it's very close because this experiment was done in the microgravity environment, and they measured the specific heat. Okay. And then the behavior of the specific heat, I mean, it's expected to have a power law, and they determine the power law from the fit. You do a fit. For this reason, it's important to have also an idea of the correlation of the corrections to the asymptotic behavior. Because since you perform a fit, but you are not at the transition, you are approaching the transition. This is the best condition. I mean, they arrived very close to 10 to minus 9. Nanokelvin, I mean, at the critical temperature, but this is the number. I mean, there are also experiments. Some experiments have been done also using cold atoms. I mean, this is a recent experiment showing the increase of the correlation length. I mean, so there are. This is another system. I mean, this if you want, for example, if you want to construct a model, I mean, an effective model for systems for boson gas, for lattice boson gas, I mean, on a optical lattice. An optical lattice is, they are able, using lasers, they are able to construct an effective lattice in which they put one atom, two atoms, and essentially put atoms only on one side, on the sides of this lattice. And this is, there are many experiments in done using these techniques. I mean, actually, these techniques allows you to have results from systems which are three-dimensional, two-dimensional, one-dimensional. So there are many the possibility to do many changes. These are called actually in Florence, many experiments are done. I mean. On these systems that are very powerful. I mean, and for example, if you have a boson, so you can capture the physics of a bosons, a boson gas, using this Hamiltonian. Here, this we introduce a field B, which is an annihilation creation of operator B, satisfying the standard commutation rules. Okay, this is a coupling, local coupling. This is model is very realistic. Okay, that's another effective model. It's quite realistic. I mean, in the sense they use this, okay, and they compare with experiments, and there is a good comparison. So this is a local interactions. This is the density, local in the sense that site-site, in the sense. This is a next nearest interaction. And this is the chemical potential. This is standard. This is called Bose-Abbar model. I mean, the Abbar model is this an analogous model, but with fermions. Okay. Okay. In this case, we observe finite temperature transitions. Okay, and these transitions are related to the formation of a Bose-Einstein condensate. Okay, and this is all. I mean, if for example, this is in the hardcore limit. We have this phase diagram. I mean, the idea is all transitions. Okay, we have changing the parameters. We have a line of transition. All these transitions have the same asymptotic behavior, and it's the same asymptotic behavior is associated with the XY universality class, which is the universality class associated with the symmetry U1. Okay, so the idea we have this model. We know that this model has a U1 symmetry. Okay, the symmetry is clear here. I mean, because we don't change the model, we don't change the spectrum when we perform this change of variable. Okay, now we have a symmetry U1. Okay, so the symmetry breaking should be U1 going to Z2, which is the parity symmetry essentially. Then we have to construct the most general Φ^4 theory. Very easy. We take a complex field. Instead of taking a real field, we take a complex field. So we have U1 symmetry, and we have our quantum field theory. Then we can perform calculations, as shown I showed you for the easy model. This is for the XY model, I mean, for the complex model. There are results from perturbative 6, 6, 7 loops. Of course, after the summation, phi loop epsilon expansion, and these are the number. Okay, they can be compared with numerical experiments. Numerical results, sorry, with numerical results, some Monte Carlo and high temperature expansions, essentially lattice techniques by two different groups, okay, and with experiment, the experiment I showed you before, okay. Okay, if you want to check field theory is okay with this and with this, because the error is quite large, I mean, when we compare with both. But let me know that there is a significant discrepancy between lattice techniques and the experiment. We can discuss on the reasons, but this is the official result of these papers. Okay, this is space shelter experiment, and these are the results from Monte Carlo simulations and high temperature expansion. Okay, but anyway, from the point of field theory, everything is okay. They agree with both of them. I mean, the error of field theory is sufficiently large to have both. Okay, that's unfortunately we cannot do better. As far as I know, there are no results from CFT. But I. Okay, thank you. So, These are, we talked about classical critical phenomena. What I mean for classical, I don't mean that the system is classical. When I talked about Bose, Hubbard model, this was a quantum Hamiltonian. Okay, for classical, I mean phenomena, critical phenomena, which are driven by thermal fluctuations, essentially. I mean, at finer temperature. Okay, that's the meaning. I can have classical critical phenomena also for quantum systems. What I mean is that I'm considering the finer temperature transition of the quantum system, as I did before, okay, for the Bose-Einstein condensation. Okay, there are also interesting transitions, and this is more recent literature. I mean, that's a more more recent work for quantum transition. Okay, they are transitions which should occur at the limit of zero temperature. I mean, so in the limit of zero temperature, we don't have any more thermal fluctuations; we have only quantum fluctuations. So these transitions are essentially driven by quantum fluctuations. Okay. What we observe? What are the main features of the quantum transition? We have a model. I mean, we change a model parameter, which could be this g, for example, here. And at some point, for some value, we observe that the low energy properties have a singular behavior. Mm? Okay, the singular behavior can have different, can have can come from level crossing, for example. I mean, we have two levels. Varying g, we can have a level crossing. This level crossing could be, in a sense, trivial if the two terms of the Hamiltonian are commuting, okay? Because the eigenvectors remains the same, so we change only the eigenvalues, so it's trivial to varying the parameter to get a level crossing of this type. But there are also non-trivial behaviors, which are more interesting, okay, when we have an avoided level crossing. I mean, what happens that if we put the system on a final volume, okay, the system has two, these are the lowest states, okay, the energy of the low states get closer and closer when you approach the critical point, and this difference, I mean, goes to zero in the infinite volume limit, okay, and this is equivalent to the continuous critical behavior we observe at final temperature transition, okay. In this case, what happens? That the gap, I mean, here it's the difference between the two low states, the gap, okay, between these two low states goes to zero. I mean, and goes to zero with a power law. This gives rise to a singularity. Okay, actually, this quantum transition essentially are mostly studied in the case of continuous quantum transition. Continuous quantum transition is also associated with a divergingless scale. Okay, we have a gap which goes to zero, a divergingless scale. I mean, if we measure the correlation, we observe that there is a length scale in the correlations, in particular those are related to the critical modes, which diverges, like continuous transition at final temperature. So let me give you an example. The standard example is the easing chain, the easing model, I mean, the quantum easing model. How to construct a quantum easing model? Well, I consider this Hamiltonian. This sigma are Pauli matrices, so they are operators. Okay, we have x here, sigma x, and sigma z. Okay, let me consider the case in which this term is absent. I mean, h is equal to a zero. Okay, when g goes to infinity, okay, you see this term is dominating. If g goes to zero, the lowest state, the ground state, is essentially given by the product of local states with spin up. Okay? What happens in the other case? So we have spin up in this case. This is a single ground state. What happens if we take the limit, we put to zero this value? Now, in this case, the ground state is done by the product of eigenstates of the matrix sigma x, but we have two ground states. There is a degeneration. Okay, we can have a spin this way or this way. Okay, so that's a big difference. I mean, that's a qualitative difference. Actually, this behavior extends also to finite g. It's not only related to the extreme values. We are considering the case of one dimension, one more dimension, one, two, and so on. Okay. What happens? Particularly, this can be done. One can perform an analytical calculation in the case of one of the easing chain. So, in one dimensional chain, what happens that at particular value, okay, there is a transition, okay, and the transition is continuous, quantum transition, because we are at zero temperature. We are only talking about the ground state, okay. There is no temperature. What happens? There is a correlation length which is diverging, and one can also relate the correlation length to the gap, and the gap is going to zero at that point. You see, with this power law. Okay? And this power law is associated with the critical exponents of the universality class. Because this is a critical phenomenon, again. Actually, in this model, we have also first order transition, quantum transition. If we are in the low, in the phase, in the ordered phase, so in this case, and we add a magnetic field H coupled to sigma X, okay? When H pass through zero, there is a discontinuity in the magnetization, which is the expectation value of sigma X. So we have a first order transition. So very similar to what happens in the case of classical models, okay? So in the case of, so we have a diverging light scale. We have continuous transition. There are small differences. We don't have a temperature. We have a gap. Okay, but things are becoming very close, very similar to what happens at critical phenomena in the case of classical theory, or classical critical phenomena. Indeed, what happens is that in general, okay, we need only one parameter to be tuned to reach the critical point. So there is only one relevant scaling field. What happens is that the correlation length goes like a power of the reduced variable. I mean, this G bar is just different from the critical value. There's an exponent which I call nu, okay? And there is another exponent associated with the behavior of the gap. The gap goes to zero like the correlation length to minus Z. Z is a new exponent, okay? That's another exponent, another critical, another power law of this system. Okay, again, I mean, another question is, what happens to the temperature if I introduce the temperature? This is important because we know that zero temperature cannot be reached, really strictly reached in experiments. So we need to understand what happens when we introduce it. We have a small temperature. Actually, this is important. I mean, and what happens is that the temperature scale has this exponent z. Actually, the temperature is, in a sense, related with the gap, with the difference of the energy of the spectrum. So that's quite natural that the scaling of the temperature is related to the scaling of the gap z. Okay, and this is the scaling law which is observed at the quantum transition. When we are close to the quantum critical point, I mean, this is the quantum critical point, okay, but at final temperature. So the theory of the critical, the theory of the quantum critical point, I mean, is essentially related to the behavior of the system, of course not when the system is at zero temperature, because we cannot reach zero temperature, but when we are in this region, the temperature is sufficiently small, I mean, and in this region, okay, we have all the phenomena associated with this critical, with this quantum critical point, okay? While we may have final temperature transitions here, but this final temperature transition are associated with the classical, they are driven by thermal fluctuations. We only look at the behavior here at zero temperature, okay? This is a general, okay, issue, in, the general issue of the theory on quantum transitions. We can also, again, as we did for critical phenomena, we can encode the critical behavior, I mean, at the quantum point, write down this homogeneous scaling laws, I mean, which are very similar to those already obtained or which I showed you in the case of classical transitions. You have a relevant field, I mean, relevant scaling field, which is associated with the difference with the G bar here, and this scales like this exponent, one, which I call 1 over nu. The temperature is another relevant scaling field in this case for this critical point, and this is associated with the exponent z. I mean, actually, this summarizes the power law critical behavior. This is the free energy, for example. This quantum scaling laws, as you can see, arise from the interplay between thermal and quantum transition and quantum fluctuations. Okay? Yeah. Yeah, we will see. We can have also Z different from one. And there are if I have time, and I show you some example in different case. Like classical transitions, again, global features determine the critical behavior. The idea is that, again, we apply the normalization group theory. So we have the same idea. We have an order parameter. We have scaling fields. We have and the critical properties, asymptotic critical properties, are only determined by a few global properties, which are the spatial dimensions, which are the symmetry breaking pattern, and so on. That's the same. I mean, the idea is the same. Okay, these are the scaling laws. I mean, if you want to summarize the normalization group theory, I mean, that's the idea is write down this. I mean, it's very useful if you want to recall the main predictions of the normalization group theory. That is what I do usually. This is you have free energy. I mean, this is free energy. This is a regular part which can be usually is neglected unless you look at the corrections, scaling corrections. And then there is singular part. The singular part obeys an homogeneous scaling law. The only difference here with respect to the critical phenomena, classical critical phenomena, that here we don't have only D, which was the special dimension of the classical transition. But we have D plus Z. I mean, we have like saying that the fluctuations, the quantum fluctuation, okay, see another dimension. Okay, and this dimension is weighted by this exponent z. Okay, but this is it's important. We'll see now. This essentially relates to the quantum to classical mapping. Okay, one of the issue we will consider in more detail in one of the next lectures. Okay, so the idea here, I don't want you to explain all the detail. The idea is that also in this case, okay, we can have scaling predictions for the free energy, for the two-point function, for whatever, for all thermodynamic quantities. Now, this is the idea, just to give you an idea now of the quantum to classical mapping, what happens that, in a sense, okay, the temperature in a quantum system can be represented as a further Euclidean dimension, okay, whose size is 1 over t, okay? That's the idea. Why this is the idea? Because there is an equivalence called quantum to classical mapping. I'll show you the details next lecture, which can associate the partition function, the quantum partition function, okay, of the model to this path integral representation of the partition function. And this path integral, we have not only spatial dimension, but we have another dimension, which is tau. It's an imaginary time, sites of this integration, of the size is just 1 over t, so if t goes to 0, we have another dimension. We have d plus 1 dimension, okay? That's the main point. We will return to this point next lecture. That's the question. If z is equal to 1, we can have z equal 1, which means that the farther dimension is essentially equivalent to the spatial dimension. Okay? The reason is that was here, because the correlation length goes like t to minus 1, essentially. The dimension, the farther dimension is essentially equivalent to the other dimensions. Okay, I'll show you later better. But we can have also quantum transition, with the z different from 1, which means that the equivalent classical behavior, classical model, is anisotropic. It's more complicated. Okay. Instead, if z is equal to one, we have a kind of new symmetry, which is d plus one. Okay, in the Euclidean space, this becomes Lorentz symmetry in the Minkowski space. Okay, z equal one. Okay, but we can have we have transitions for other. For example, the mod to superfluid transition, quantum transition, has z equal to two. I mean, you can have a different value of z. Yeah. It could be that there are transitions, but I don't know any example. I have to think a little more, but I don't have an example. So we can have also first order quantum transitions, and don't have time to. How much time do I have? 10? 1 minute? 20. Okay, let me. So let's have a list of applications where quantum transitions are observed. At least there are claims that quantum transitions have been observed in the literature. Of course, in the case of quantum magnetism. This is a quantum critical point is believed to be important to understand the phenomenology of high temperature superconductors. Actually, I mean, at the beginning, it became very popular, this theory, because of the high temperature superconductors. The quantum transition observed in quantum particle systems, I will give you some example. For example, one may consider transitions in Fermi atomic systems. There is an important research, many groups, experimental groups, which are looking for new matter states, okay, new quantum matter states. Very interesting are these spin liquids, which are very entangled states. We're talking about whatever you observe when you approach zero temperature comes from quantum fluctuations. So you have entanglement phenomena. They are very important. And you can also distinguish the different phases using entanglement. And this has been done, for example, if you want to study topological transitions. Okay? So I don't have time to go into the details, but the theory can be applied to many, many different systems, which are very interesting, you know. Just to give you some flavor, I mean, of the experimental results. For example, this is fine temperature transition. These are experiments with cold atoms. But this is in the limit of zero temperature. In which they observe the Mott phases, there is the physical Mott phase. Now I will show you some results for these transitions. Just a few words. No, if we study the Ising chain or we study quantum Heisenberg models, the quantum transition, okay, the critical behavior, the universality class of the quantum transition, okay. Is equivalent. I mean, it's the same universality class of classical systems in d plus one dimensions. Okay, and usually these quantum transitions are characterized by a, let's say, trivial dynamic exponent z. Okay, dynamic exponent z is the exponent controlling the gap, controlling the scaling of the temperature. In that case, z is equal to one. Okay. In the case of the Ising chain, I showed you before, z is equal to 1. And indeed, they are very interesting because there is a CFT. I mean, you can construct a conformal field theory, okay? And then you can get a lot of results. But there are also, I mean, different systems in which the dynamic exponent is not 1, okay, but 2. That was the question, I mean, at least. And this is the example. I mean, we have here the Bose-Abbard model. We'll stick with the Bose-Abbard model, I mean, as before. This is a boson gaze. We have several atoms. They are bosonic. Their nature is bosonic. Okay. There is a lattice here. I mean, you see the minimum. This is constructed using lasers. Okay. What happens? At some point, okay, the system prefers to be organized to be very ordered. I mean, once, for example, one atom per site. Okay, usually you don't have one atom per site. Okay, even though you have the same number of the number of particles is equal to the number of sites, okay, you can have the you can have two particles, zero particles on each site, okay. At some point, for some values of the parameters, okay, you pass from a superfluid phase in which the atoms can go around in the lattice to say to a situation in which the ground state is done is this one, okay, with one site per site, two particle per site, and so on, and these are called MOT phases. I mean, okay, it's incompressible. If you take the derivative with respect to the chemical potential of the density of a state, it's zero. Okay. Now one can study the transition and construct the effective quantum field theory describing this transition. Okay. If you do the calculation, I mean, I don't have time to show you before, but you find that the theory is not anymore the phi to the four theory, okay, standard phi to the four theory. I mean, but there is another further term, okay, which is this one. And this, in a sense, is called, since this arises from non-relativistic, I mean, Schrödinger equations, this is a non-relativistic quantum field theory associated with non-relativistic particles, okay? And this, the critical behavior described by this theory, okay, which has its own peculiar behaviors, are observed when we pass, when we change the chemical potential along these lines. These are the lines of the MOT transitions. Unless we are here, okay, the transition here is such that you can sell this linear derivative and you get back a relativistic quantum field theory. Indeed, this is this transition here is in the xy, d plus 1 xy universality class, while this one is non-relativistic quantum field theory. Okay, different exponents, different, that's different behavior. Okay, so just to give you an example that Z can be different from one you have interesting theory. This means that the scaling of the temperature, the scaling of the gap is different. And of course you don't have a CFT, conformal field theory disk. Just, we have essentially considered the critical phenomena which are described by simple phi to the four theories, okay? Okay, we have also considered the quantum version of the transition. We have seen that essentially they can be essentially described by using the same framework. Once we recognize that the effective number of dimensions at the quantum transition is this plus one, okay, where this plus one could be equivalent to the other dimension, but could be also anisotropic. I mean, it's a different system. Okay, let me consider more complicated systems now, okay? I mean, this theory here, for example, this framework can describe also other, okay, transition, more complicated transition. For more complicated, I mean that the order parameter could be a matrix, for example. The symmetry breaking is more complex than simply O(n) going to n minus 1, okay? And we have many transitions of this type, okay? Many critical behavior which are characterized by more complicated theory. So the idea is the same. We construct, we have a system, okay? We look at the system, okay? We get information, we infer by simple measurements that the critical modes are described by some kind of order parameter with its own nature, which could be a vector, a matrix, whatever. We try to understand, infer the symmetry of the system, the global symmetry of the system, this symmetry breaking, then we construct the most general theory, okay, with the same symmetries. Okay, of course we need to have, in order to use bosonic theories, scalar theories, we need to have bosonic critical modes. I mean, okay. Actually, the idea is the same. Okay, just to give you a number of examples of theory which are studied in literature, you can have as an order parameter, M times N matrix. Again, another matrix, but different combination of interactions leading to a particular symmetry, for example, here, OM times ON. Okay? This model here, very complicated, is relevant for spin density, spin density wave systems. Just an example. This model here is similar to UN times UN. It's constructed using complex N times N matrix. Okay? So you consider this theory, more complicated theories, if you need, of course. If your systems give you, I mean, must be described in terms of more complicated objects. SUN cross SUN. For example, here we can have theory with the symmetry ON1 plus ON2, which is describe the competition of two order parameters. Okay? And these are important theories. Which are important, I mean, in the sense that you find them useful to describe some critical phenomena described, I mean, observed in experiments. Again, that's the same. You can study this. In this case, you perform independently two transformations. The other case is essentially related to a matrix. You have a matrix. Yeah, because in this case, associated with a matrix, in this case, you have two independent vector fields. I mean, anyway, I can show you this. The type of transformation here, and here in this case I use plus because I have a scalar for each, as you can see. If I transform, I do a 1-2 transformation for the field phi 2, I have a symmetry, but this is dependent on the other one. Anyway, that's a matter of, I don't know if in the group language, in the group theory language, what's the most rigorous notation. Okay. Let me say, I show you Joe's just to give you an example. This is the theory, general theory. One can use the same framework used in the case of ON theories, defining a mass M here, inverse correlation length. Defining new couplings, G, renormalized couplings. Again, one can perform high-order computations. I mean, for the theories I showed you before, calculation has been done up to five, six looks, depending on the type of calculations. Again, one can use the ideas of the Borel summability, resumming the series, otherwise you don't get any accurate results for two-dimensional systems and so on. Now we have more couplings, or quartic couplings. So the renormalization group flow is more complicated. The beta functions, we have several beta functions, one beta function for every quartic coupling, okay? And you have a set of coupled equations, okay? But again, I mean, for example, here it's a case in which we have two quartic parameters, U and V. Again, I mean, the flow is controlled by the fixed points, and the fixed points are the common zeros of the beta functions. So there is an extension of what happens in one dimension, okay? And this can be proved using the normalization group equations, okay? I don't have time to show you this. So what happens? We have this beta function, we compute them, we resum them if you need, if we can. And then we look for the zeros, common zeros, and these are the fixed points. Okay? The critical behavior, okay, of the system, of that system, I mean, is described by the stable fixed point of the theory. Okay? And the theory, the stable fixed point has its own perturbations. Okay? So there are a number of normalization group dimensions associated with the perturbations. And those which are relevant give the exponent, the critical exponent. I mean, the asymptotic behavior. That's the same. Actually, I should say that, let me assume that we find a stable fixed point, okay? A stable fixed point means that there is a common zero, but also the stability matrix has a positive real, positive eigenvalues. Okay? This is stable. If we have a stable fixed point, I mean, okay, what we can predict for the system. We have our system, okay? We can predict that the system can have a continuous transition. We cannot be sure that the system undergoes a continuous transition. We can only say that if the system is experiencing a continuous transition, this continuous transition must be in the universality class described by the stable fixed point of the theory. But you can also have that your system corresponds to renormalization group trajectories which are running away, I mean, not going to the fixed point, but running away. In that case, you would have first order transition. So, in a sense, if you don't find a stable fixed points, you have a prediction. The transition is first order. If you find a stable fixed point, I mean, the prediction is, in the case the system is undergoing a continuous transition, then, okay, this is the critical behavior. But you cannot exclude the first order transition. Okay, that's an important point. Okay, for example, just an example. I conclude with this example. I want to show a simple extension of the model I considered before, which is the Bose-Hammer model. I mean, leading to the Bose-Einstein condensation. Okay, this is a simple extension, but we will see that different symmetry breaking patterns, a more complicated theory arise from this simple system. Okay, this is the Bose-Hammer model, but for let's say spin 1/2 boson gas. Okay, let's imagine a spin 1/2. Or if you want, from a more physical point of view, let's consider two equal species of bosonic gases. Okay, and they interact. S is a parameter, which in this case takes value 1 or 2. Okay, it's equal in the sense the interaction. V, of course, they are distinguishable. Otherwise, of course, that's okay. They are equal but distinguishable. Okay, and they interact through this side term. Okay, that's a simple extension. Okay, now we want to understand what happens. What kind of Bose-Einstein condensation patterns we have in this theory? It's the same as before. Okay. Now let me first consider this symmetry. Okay. We have a U1 symmetry for each field, B. Okay. But we have also an exchange symmetry. So I would write down the global group in this way, whatever it means, okay, to give an idea. Okay. Actually, if we consider, we can do a mean field analysis of the phase diagram. This can be easily done. And you find that you have different kind of patterns. You can have a transition here. You can, of course, you have a disordered phase, okay, in which here I'm considering finite temperature transition, okay, thermal transition, classical transition, but more complicated ones. We have high temperature order phase in which there is not any condensation, okay. But we can have also a region in the phase diagram in which both particles, both gases condense, or region in which only one condense. Okay? So this is the difference. It's clear. That's if you do the calculation, if you calculation is very simple. You check, and you find, of course, high temperature phase and two different low temperature phase. One of them is characterized by the simultaneous condensation of the two gases. The other one from the condensation only one. Okay, that's just an example of phase diagram. So this is the one to study the critical behavior at this transition. Okay, this is the global symmetry, the starting global symmetry. So when we have the condensation, I mean, let me write down this, the condensation of both gases, both species, then the breaking is, the symmetry breaking is this one. okay? Because the condensation of both species means that U1 goes to Z2, each single one. Hmm? And this is symmetry breaking. But when we have in condensation only one, we break the exchange symmetry, but we also break in one U1, and we get this. Okay? It's a two symmetry breaking patterns. Okay? Now the point, does it mean that the critical behavior associated with the Bose-Einstein condensation is different? Okay? Well, as I said before, one of the paradigma, I mean, of the normalization group theory is that the critical behavior is essentially determined by the symmetry breaking pattern. Okay? If we have a different symmetry breaking pattern, then we should expect a different critical behavior. Okay? Now let's check if this is true. Let's use the same kind of approach. I mean, we want to construct the corresponding Landau, Gisbol, Wilson, 5 to the 4 theory. Okay? We consider one order parameter for each guess. Okay? So we have one complex field for each guess. But we have two complex fields. Okay? So we have two complex fields, phi s. Okay? We have, of course, a quartic term for each bosonic guess. But we also have interaction between these two order parameters. Okay? This is quite intuitive. Actually, I mean, if you see there is a clear correspondence between this coupling here, which is associated with the intraspecies coupling, and this U, which is related to interspecies coupling. Okay? Sorry? It's not realistic because we are talking about the finite temperature transition. The non-relativistic case was when we considered at zero temperature MOTU, okay? So this is a week we went back. So we have this theory, relatively simple. And again, if we look at the symmetry breaking patterns associated with this theory, we see that there are two different symmetry breaking patterns. If G minus U is positive, you can check using mean field calculation or the minima of this potential, which is simple calculation, looking at the minima of the phi to the fourth potential, okay, you can see that the vacuum, I mean the minimum, has these properties, therefore you have this symmetry breaking. Instead, if this is negative, you find that the minimum of the potential, okay, has this, has only one condensate. Of course, if G is equal to U, okay, we go back to a ON theory with the symmetry of 4. Okay, we are concluding. Last slide. These are two quartic parameters. It's more complicated, but you can do the same normalization group analysis. This is the flow in the two quartic parameters. One look for stable fixed points, and the analysis, the perturbative analysis after resummation, shows that there are two, I mean, stable fixed points. One is this one, okay, called the couplet xy. In this region, this is an unstable fixed point, but there is another stable fixed point. And these two regions corresponds to the two different symmetry breaking patterns I showed you before. Okay? So this implies that if let's assume we observe a simultaneous condensation of both gases, okay, then and the transition is continuous, okay? Then we can predict that the critical behavior, asymptotic critical behavior, is controlled by this fixed point, which means that we know the critical exponents and we know all universal features, okay? But if we observe, we have this system, and we observe the condensation of only one of the two components, okay? And we observe that there is a continuous critical behavior, the transition is continuous, then the prediction is that this is controlled by the other stable fixed point, which has different critical exponents. Indeed, the exponents are quite different. Okay? I showed you this example just to show you how this paradigm based on Landau, Gisbert, Wilson works. Okay? Of course, we are assuming that the theory, the critical modes, are described by this theory. This is an effective theory. Okay? Sometimes this that you can make. If you don't recognize the natural order parameter, if in your system, for some reasons, there are systems examples, long-range interactions, then it could be that you are making a mistake in the choice of the order parameter. So what you predict here is not equivalent to what you should observe in the system. So there is an assumption. This assumption is quite strong, but this is a framework. I mean, a strong framework which can give you predictions. Okay, let's. I think that I'll conclude. I wanted to finish with another example, which was taken from chromodynamic. I mean, for the Mendeleev time. If you are interested, we can talk for the transition. I mean, the final temperature transition of hadrons. I mean, the transition I was talking at the beginning when we showed you the Big Bang evolution. There is a transition to 100 MeV from a phase in which we have quarks, essentially, to a phase in which we have hadrons. I mean, what kind of transition? The chiral transition. So this transition can be also investigated using the same kind of framework. Okay. From which you get a prediction that you can compare with what observed, observed is difficult in this case, but what numerical observed in Monte Carlo simulations. Okay, I think that's I close here. Next lecture will be done at the blackboard. I mean, focusing on some of the issues. Okay, I discussed here very briefly, for example, quantum to classical mappings, phi to the four theory, normalization group theory, calculations, perturbative calculations, so some of these features, but there will be much more. The style will be the standard style of lecture, not the of presentation. Okay.